All right, everybody, it is time for another episode of The Nostalgia Trap. I am your host, David Parsons. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for listening to the show, no matter how you found it. 2018 was a really big year. We're heading up to the holidays and wrapping up another year of Nostalgia Trap. When I started this podcast, I had no idea that it would grow into the thing it's become. And what it is still something to be discovered. I think the Nostalgia Trap is, we do a lot of things on this show. So for listeners that are just finding us, you know, I started out wanting to just interview the people that I went to graduate school with, both other students and professors. I wanted to share particularly the ideas of history and politics that informed the person that I was. And I wanted to share personal stories of people who were engaged in studying politics, in the media, even people that are activists and organizers. So in a broad sense, I thought the show was a chance to talk to people from the left and talk to them about their lives, kind of where they came from, who their parents were, and how all that kind of personal experience informed their politics, informed their view of history, etc. I mean, we also just do a lot of shows where we just talk about current events. We talk about what's going on. I mean, it's hard to ignore the Trump era, but I hope that on this show that the kind of framing that we do always kind of contains that biographical instinct as well. So a lot of stuff about personal lives. And so for me, you know, personally, who am I? My name is David Parsons. I was born in Southern California many years ago in the late 70s. I am informed by a lot of different, I think, historical factors and personal factors too. But just in a to hit the kind of resume type stuff, you know, I went to school in Southern California during the 80s and 90s. The LA riots were very close to me when that happened, and a big part of I think an awakening about race and class for me at a very young age. I was in junior high, and I went to UC Santa Barbara where I studied history and film studies. So I was introduced to film theory, and particularly like the Frankfurt School and postmodernism and all that stuff by a really wonderful set of professors in the film studies department at UC Santa Barbara. I really can't speak highly enough about the level of rigor that I was introduced to in an undergraduate program. I think it's kind of extraordinary still when I think back at all the kind of high level theorists I was introduced to and the kinds of films we watched, the kinds of things that were expected of us. So, you know, the kind of 90s film studies, All the cultural stuff going on in the 90s, particularly around grunge and the third wave of feminism, all that stuff stuck with me very powerfully. I ended up going to the City University of New York, the Graduate Center. I started there in 2004, where I ended up getting a PhD in American history. I studied particularly the 1960s and 1970s, and particularly left politics, American left politics around the Vietnam War. Ended up writing a book that you can go check out on Amazon and everywhere else, published by the University of North Carolina Press, a great press that puts out really great books about American history, and in particular books that touch on the Vietnam War. So I'm really proud to have had my book published by UNC Press. It's called Dangerous Grounds: Anti-War Coffee Houses and Military Dissent in the Vietnam Era. And writing that book, you know, really kind of made me think a lot about the American left, particularly the anti-war movement, but in a broader sense, socialism and communism and anarchism and all that stuff. So that informed me as well. And when I was at the CUNY Graduate Center, I also was in the film program there and completed their program of film study stuff. So I came back to all the stuff about postmodernism, authorship. I'm really into cinema. I'm really into visual media. I'm really into the way those things intersect with left politics. So that tells you a little bit about me. And on this show, I try to talk to people about their kind of trajectory, both personally and ideologically, and where they're at in their lives now. So if you enjoy that kind of stuff, check out our whole catalog. We've got all of it up at nostalgiatrap.com. And if you like what we're doing, we also have bonus episodes where we talk a little deeper, a little crazier about the more apocalyptic elements of what's happening, often with my friend Justin Rogers Cooper. You can check out those bonus episodes at our Patreon page and become a patron of the show. It really helps us out. In fact, it keeps the show alive. The people who are listening and are subscribing and getting our bonus material. are the people who are making it possible for the Nostalgia Trap to keep putting episodes up week after week, which is what we want to continue to do. So if you are in on the project and can help us out at all, it would be really appreciated. Go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. And you can sign up and become a regular customer and regular supporter of the show. And again, it really makes everything we do possible. So thanks for that. Okay, so let's get to Max Alvarez. He's someone who we've had on the show before. I always enjoy the second time I bring guests on because we're able to kind of get over the initial awkwardness of our interaction and start talking about some of the weirder stuff I like to get into. And today was a good example of that. I wanted to talk to Max about particularly the stuff he's doing around General Motors, the article that he recently wrote in Current Affairs about his podcast, Working People, and the experience of interviewing his father. So we got into that, but we also ended up talking a lot about, I don't know, the more kind of philosophical and psychological and personal elements of the kind of labor that people do under the capitalism we're living under in 2018. So we got into talking about like social media and alienation and, you know, driving an Uber and what that means to the kind of inner life of a human being. So, a very common idea on this show is that capitalism, you know, basically robs us of our humanity by putting us into a system that makes us work all the time, and we hate that because the work that we're doing is alienating. And I think that the politics that we get into of that, you know, it'll touch on stuff like Bernie Sanders, the DSA, Michael Harrington, Jacobin, all that kind of politics, even Angela Nagel we get into. But we also talk about like Kafka, David Foster Wallace. You know, Max is a Russian literature guy, so he's always going to have a literary kind of way of putting things. And I think we have a lot of examples of that in this conversation. So I hope you enjoy this. And again, go check out Max's show, Working People, which you can find all over where you get podcasts. Thanks a lot for listening to the show. It's been a great 2018. I look forward to a greater 2019. We're trying to be optimistic on this show. So thanks again for listening, and I hope you enjoy this conversation. Here is me talking with Max Alvarez. Max, it's really good to talk to you. I've been following your stuff since the last time we talked, and you know, you've been doing a lot of stuff with General Motors and your podcast, Working People. You did, I'm going to toot your horn a little bit because I think the stuff you're doing is important, but there's a particular piece I wanted to point my listeners to. If you haven't checked it out, I know a lot of you are looking at Current Affairs, but go to currentaffairs.org and check out Max's latest piece called Can the Working Class Speak? To me, like, your piece really captures a lot of what we try to do on Nostalgia Trap, which is kind of mix the personal and the political and really hit the personal end more. And it's just a really like shattering piece about your family and the particular relationship to labor that has existed, particularly with your father. That stuff is like, what, first of all, like, why, I guess I wanted to ask you, why now? Like, why did you write that piece now? What took you so long? But more kind of like, what happened in your life or in your family or even in like the wider kind of political landscape that made you think that a piece like this was necessary? Because I feel like it's a different piece than you usually write, Max.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. It's by far, I think, my most personal piece. You know, it kind of blends a lot of personal narrative with kind of argument and critique. And, you know, honestly, it kind of parallels, to answer your question, like my path to writing this piece, I think, parallels the path of my dad, which I talk about in the piece. Mm-hmm. The path my dad took to kind of confronting the reality of what our family went through during the recession. And I guess to give a little bit of a backstory for folks who don't know or haven't listened to the podcast, you know, the very first episode that I did of Working People, and at this point I still didn't really have like a full clear sense of what I wanted the show to be. But you know, I'd been talking to my dad, when I was back home, and you know, like you asked like why it took so long. You know, in the piece, I talk about how, you know, I mean, our family lost everything in the recession. We lost the house I grew up in. You know, we've all been kind of fumbling around for any sort of lifeline for the past decade, and have only kind of started to kind of creep back into some sense of normalcy. But I mean, you know, for all intents and purposes, we're still, you know, pretty much all living paycheck to paycheck and stuff like that. But, you know, it's less dire than it was a couple years ago. But, you know, even after kind of the financial weight was lifted, like, marginally, the, like, psychological and existential weight of everything was still very much there for all of us. And especially, you know, my dad, I could see it in him, and I think I you know, noticed it more in him because I was seeing in him a lot of what I myself was going through. And, you know, I am my father's son. There's a lot of, like, qualities from my dad that I have kind of inherited, so many that I love and that I recognize more and more as I get older, but also some that, you know, like, aren't exactly you know, good for either of us. And one of those is that, you know, like, learning how to kind of talk openly and honestly about kind of the personal, psychological, emotional kind of traumas that he's been through in his life and that our family, you know, has kind of been experiencing and all that kind of stuff. And so, you know, I talk in the piece about how, you know, for years I had noticed that my dad became, you know, he was never that much of a chatterbox, but I could see how he was becoming much more silent, much more, like I said that, like, you know, one Christmas I just noticed that he was like, you know, a life-sized static, that it just seemed like he became kind of illegible to us. And I think he didn't even really know it himself, but, you know, I you know, it broke my heart and I know his heart was broken. But again, like, none of us really kind of had the tools to deal with this together. And so what we did was we all started to recede into ourselves and suppress parts of the reality that we were all experiencing in order to maintain some sort of, like, mirage of normalcy, something that would allow us to kind of get through the day and maintain this feeling that things were okay or things were going to be okay. And I mean, those, we needed to do that to get by, and that, you know, kind of mirage of normalcy always kind of abruptly and sharply and menacingly stopped whenever, like, you know, an unpayable bill came in the mail, or, you know, we got a phone call about something we needed to pay or something we couldn't pay. And so I know this is a long way to answer it, but, like, you know, I could see and feel how this kind of, like, this sort of situation was leading all of us to kind of lose ourselves and even begin to, like, lose each other at a time when we needed each other more than ever. And, you know, like, I think we all started to deal with it in our different ways. You know, I started, like, you know, going to therapy this year, and I think that helped a bit with me being able to talk about stuff. But I also, you know, when the last time I was back home, which was before I started the podcast, I was talking to my dad, and I could notice, like, the glimmer of a change in him. And that change was, which I talk about in the current affairs piece, is kind of like it's like an unintended or unpredicted consequence of, like, the work that my dad was doing to kind of make it out of this hole. So, like, after we lost everything, right, we all did whatever we had to do to get some money. I talk about like my temp jobs in warehouses and factories and stuff, and I talk about how my dad started driving Uber, like, you know, 8 hours a day on top of, like, you know, trying to work in real estate.
Can I ask you about Uber just real quick? Because it seems like it felt like a critical part of the story, that your dad driving for Uber, in the sense of, like, I don't know, there was a kind of meme or idea in the 90s of, like, older people going and working at Walmart, and this kind of, like, sad thing. You even saw it in the culture. I think actually Obama used the image of an older man working at Walmart to kind of, like, call to some idea of the working class being, like, exploited all the way to the end. And, like, Uber is a particularly, you know, is a particularly exploitative company. And that part of it, because my dad talks about Uber a lot, and he wonders, like, can I make money? He doesn't think that he wants to do it, because he thinks that it sounds like it'll be a ripoff. But did it feel like that to you, like your dad working for Uber had a particularly I don't know, pathos to it because of the kind of politics of Uber and the politics of labor that you study and think about?
I mean, yeah, and I, you know, I mentioned in the piece that, like, you know, when he started driving for Uber, like, it broke my heart, because I was aware of like your dad said, I'm aware of, like, all the bullshit that they try to sell you about being your own boss and what have you, and knowing that, you know, they do not pay what they should. They are part of this entire gig economy that is, like, trying to push more and more costs and risk onto the actual workers.
Yeah.
And while, like, scooping off as much and much of the profits for the companies themselves. So I knew that, but, you know, I also knew that, you know, we kind of didn't have any other options. But, you know, like, I was saying, I think the thing that that I didn't expect, and that kind of really prompted me to think about starting the podcast, which in turn kind of allowed me to kind of write the piece for Current Affairs, and in the process confront a lot of stuff that was kind of, like, in the back of my mind and in the back of my heart over the past decade, was, I was talking to my dad over the summer about driving for Uber, and I could, you know, he's an incredibly lovely man, my dad. Like I said, he's not particularly chatty, but I mean, like, when he's in, like, you know, kind of realtor mode or Uber mode, like, you know, he's good at picking up small talk, and you know, I think that was kind of, like, where it started, that he was just kind of trying to, because you see this when you get in Ubers all the time, and sometimes it's really sad where, you know, your driver clearly doesn't want to talk to you, but they're asking you questions about your day because they're worried that if they don't engage, you're going to, you know, give them a lower rating, right, or something like that.
Yeah, that's a Black Mirror episode, I think, literally, how, like, our social interactions are driven by this kind of, like, this notion that we're being rated, and that rating directly affects our bottom line. It's like it's a really terrifying idea, because it means that we're performing all the time.
It does. And I mean, it's such a like society of the spectacle kind of example that I find horrifyingly apt. And
I know you're a David Foster Wallace fan. It sounds like Infinite Jest to me, honestly. Like, the more I think about, like, and the more I look back at a lot of Wallace's work, I'm like, he kind of saw a lot of the really dark pathological elements of that, you know, more technological that more technological society that melds technology with labor and with service and all that stuff together has created a kind of a real kind of, I think, trauma among human beings that are adjusting to this reality and not often so well. But it's also, you know, the landscape of capitalist exploitation in a way that opened up you know, a new kind of phase of something that's been going on for a long time, this collapse. I mean, I wanted to ask you really quickly, 'cause to get back to your family, you know, in my family, we talked about money all the time. My parents worried about money all the time, openly. Like, it was like growing up, money was just a constant kind of subject of conversation. But just in terms of like the practical things, you know, how are we going to pay these bills? How do we create a budget that works for the family? How do we get out of debt? But there was never like as much connection to that, to the kind of personal element of that. In other words, we talked about the money thing of it, but like the sadness from it, you know, the like kind of embarrassment, the humiliation, the trauma that I think both my mom and dad felt of like involved with their working lives. That part of it didn't get discussed as much. Is that how it was in your family? Did you have a kind of like, we talked about money, but we didn't really get to the root of what was so troubling about it. Was that split happening in your family too?
Yeah, very much so. And you know, I'll try to kind of respond to that by also kind of tying up what I was taking a long time to say in the previous question.
Yeah, sorry, I keep interrupting you. You have so many. For me, it's like there's so many things I don't want to lose. There's little lines that I want to just kind of mark down.
Yeah.
But yeah, go ahead.
Well, no, I mean, they're all connected, man. And you know, I think that you're absolutely that these are absolutely the right questions, and that these are exactly the kinds of things that I was trying to kind of address in total with the current affairs piece and with this podcast. But I guess the last thing I wanted to say about my dad driving Uber.
Yeah.
Is that the unintended consequence of that was that I noticed that he was taking his work home with him, in the sense that he was coming back and telling us about the conversations he would have with the people that he was driving. And, you know, like, people who are my dad's age, I mean, people who have been working their whole lives, and also now like people who have been working in professions that are more solitary, you know, like there really weren't that many other outlets for my dad other than our like family and our extended family. There weren't that many outlets for him to really kind of see his situation from a different lens, from outside of what he was experiencing every day. And it was only in like driving strangers around in Uber in Southern California that, you know, he began to realize just how widespread all of this stuff was. So he was talking to, you know, folks his age who were, you know, on their way to their second or third job, or folks his age who had lost their house too and who were constantly worrying about how they would never be able to retire and stuff like that. Yeah. And I think that in, because of that, my dad started to realize in a way that he never could or would when like we were trying to tell him this, because we were all too close to it. But he started to realize that he wasn't alone, and that this was, you know, a problem that, you know, like was plaguing so many other people and families that were in the same boat as we were. And in that regard, I think he started to be able to lift himself out of that kind of existential quagmire that he had been in, that all of us had been in, and to kind of, you know, understand his pain and suffering in the context of a shared struggle,
rather than a personal failure, right?
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
which is that's something that comes up in my classes all the time, and my students seem to understand. And I think that you probably have the same experience. They understand the kind of like the pressure and the kind of like phoniness of that idea that poverty or struggling with struggling economically is related to like your personal failings. They get generally that's bullshit, and that like there are systems and people are poor not because of because they've done something wrong or they're morally bankrupt, but poverty is, you know, connected to systems and that kind of thing. I feel like people understand that, but at the same time, especially older people, I think, you know, really have internalized that deeply. And yeah, and I know it's present in my family that it's not, it's it, it poverty is something that, I mean, we make fun of poor people a lot in this country. Like, I grew up watching, I don't know if you remember, like, watching Jerry Springer and that kind of thing, that, like, kind of, like, idea of, like, the culture of poverty being this, like, kind of disgusting laziness. That notion is pushed on you everywhere, and you can find that kind of Horatio Alger bullshit myth really laced throughout the culture still, you know, in stories about athletes and stories about all sorts of people lifting themselves up. So then it, like, you know, it hammers in that idea that if I'm, like, can't make my bills this month, I'm a piece of shit. And, like, I've fucked up somehow. And it's embarrassing, and you can't tell other people about it because they'll look down upon you. That, I mean, that to me has been, like, a hallmark of my experience with you know, my own family and the families around me. But I think what you're saying is really important, that, like, hearing each other's voices and hearing that other people are going through the same things allows people to kind of dissipate that personal guilt and that feeling that they've done something wrong to deserve where they're at. I mean, it's still, I mean, it's a very Christian idea, it seems like, too. It's melded to a lot of different powerful ideologies in American culture have driven us crazy, and to the point where we think that if we don't have the money to make whatever insane expense of living in America is, then we've done something wrong. That to me is such a key part of kind of building the kind of solidarity that we would need to overcome the kind of capitalist nightmare win right now.
I think so, man. And I think you're absolutely right.
Make people feel like pieces of shit, right? I mean, you mentioned heartbreak of Uber with your father, but I feel that heartbreak all the time, and being like, God, I wish my family members that aren't making it, and the people that I know, and even the people that I don't know, I wish they would not internalize that stuff to the point where they've created, like, a nation of people who feel who have basically, you know, ruined self-esteem because they're poor. And that's just a fucking nightmare to me.
It is. And like I said, I think you're absolutely spot on. And this is honestly I think one of the really big takeaways of the podcast, and especially the GM series, is that, you know, I've been in talking to, you know, all these workers around the country, in talking to GM workers at plants in Ohio, Michigan, and Canada. You know, one of the things that just rises to the surface is how much contempt we have for our fellow workers, and how much of that, you know, contempt we turn into self-loathing when it applies to our own situation.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, you're right. We are so absolutely vicious to each other in terms of empathizing with, you know, a struggle that ultimately we are all a part of. You know, this is like the massive, long-standing problem of the American capitalist religion that, you know, I like, you know, one podcast isn't gonna upend that, but I do think that it's more incumbent upon us than ever to try to kind of chip away at that. You know, Kafka once kind of said that literature needs to be the axe with which to break the frozen sea inside of you. And I kind of like that image always, like, comes into my head when I think about kind of the necessary work of finding the common humanity that we all share that has been frozen over by life under late capitalism. And in whatever ways we can, we need to take our axes and our hatchets and our pickaxes to that kind of frozen sea and hack away until we begin to find each other again and to realize that we were meant for more than this.
Yeah,
and that,
yeah, right. And that our lives, that, I mean, our lives are consumed by this to the point where, you know, we don't find out who we really are. You know what I mean? Like, ultimately all the kind of time that and energy of our lives is spent making money. And the result is lives that are just gone because your soul is connected to that instead of really, you know, being the kind of contemplative human beings that we really are. I mean, when I think about like the people, like, you know, the notion of that we grew up with kind of like 9 to 5 working for the weekend kind of idea, that even that to me is sad. But it's gotten to the point where there's not going to be a weekend even anymore with the gig economy, and the kind of idea that everyone has to hustle, which I feel all the time as like a contingent academic, a person with a podcast. I have like I have a million little jobs rather than like one big job. And the result is, you know, I'm basically working all the time. It just feels like I'm always consumed with work. And it's kind of like we've erased the border between kind of the leisure personality and the work personality. I mean, this is the stuff that even in the history of the industrial working class, you know, the unions fought for the idea of, you know, 8 hours of work and 8 hours of rest and 8 hours of recreation, right? In other words, they kind of worked in a balanced life. And it seems like even that, which I don't know if I even agree with that, I'm much more, I think 8 hours is too much a day. But either way, that idea seems like it's disintegrating right in front of us. And it becomes even more, you know, an economy in which people are workers, quote unquote, at every hour of the day. And that's a terrifying idea.
It is. And I mean, like, and to I guess kind of like make it even more terrifying, like, you know, you mentioned David Foster Wallace and kind of, you know, his sense of kind of the more personal and psychological ways that this kind of system manifests. And I think that's something that we need to include in this discussion, right? Because like you're saying, especially in the gig economy, especially people for our and the next generation, right? Like, work doesn't stop because work has been so thoroughly imbricated in every aspect of our daily lives, even when, and especially when we are not getting paid for it. Like, this is something my brother Zach and I are like going to put out either a separate podcast about or a special series for working people, because he's an economist, I'm a lefty nut job, and we've been focusing on this question of labor. And on another podcast called Mid-Atlantic, we kind of brought this up for the first time, where we were pointing out the fact that you know, the very understanding of what work is that we are applying to our lives is like vastly insufficient for the realities that we're living in the 21st century. Because, you know, you and I, before we started recording, we were talking about kind of social media and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Like, I mean, here's kind of one of the basic examples about, like, you know, what we're talking about. But social media is something that we do not have the language to talk about in order to understand that it is a form of labor that we are just not getting paid for.
Yeah.
And I know that may sound ridiculous, but again, ask people to think for a second, like, how does Facebook make money? How does Google make money? Like, you are not the customer for these platforms.
You're the content. Yeah,
you are the product. Exactly.
Yeah.
You are the product that they are selling to advertisers and so on and so forth. And they have essentially broken the laws of physics that or the laws of economics in terms of like labor needing to be remunerated in some sort of way. And they have essentially created a new 21st century market in which labor can be monetized without being remunerated at all. And even worse, that people will willfully work for these companies and produce value for these companies, thinking that they are the customers.
Right.
And,
yeah. And they,
you know,
and
I wanted to mention,
they've kind of made narcissism like a central engine in and driving that, so that to the point where people are, they don't think they're working. They think they're participating in like creating a personality online or something like that, but they're providing content.
Right. Well, and so this is why I wanted to circle back and bring David Foster Wallace back up, right?
Yeah.
And the society of the spectacle kind of thing, right? Because this is also something that I try to talk about in the Current Affairs article. And, you know, I don't think I had recognized myself how much of David's work was in what I was trying to say, but I think you're absolutely right that it's there. But You know, like I well, talk
he was
about.
He was always about like kind of like the pathos. You know, at the core of the American, you know, consumer experience or the American lifestyle in the 21st century, the late 20th century. Yeah, he was always about kind of how sad we all are. I mean, he's kind of he was a dark motherfucker, dude. Like, really, when I go back now, I was reading a couple. I was looking for a good quote from him about taxes because I love Pale King and like I really loved like kind of the way he. Constructed the idea of boredom in that, but one of the ideas that he had that I think will circle back to what you're talking about with technology and social media and things like that. He said that if you go to any American and in the middle of just a regular conversation with them, just stop and ask them what's wrong and watch their face. They'll always kind of be relieved to kind of be relieved of the burden of performing and say that they'll always recognize that there is something wrong, in other words. And so he kind of like wanted to, I think he wanted to identify and talk a lot about this kind of underneath the surface of all the performance we do. And I think social media is forcing us to perform, you know, in a much more profound sense than even the internet stuff that was happening in the 90s. That underneath that performance is always like the kind of core, and that core he always identified as some kind of distance, alienated sadness. I mean, one of the things that I remember from Infinite Jest, one of the more memorable kind of bits in that is he had a description of a technology company that like created these masks. Do you remember this? That like the masks that people wear. Basically, he was describing FaceTime or Skype, but it was like people were so overwhelmed with seeing each other's faces on these video screenings, like video conference things, that a company created like a series of masks that people wore that became very popular. And these masks were essentially like a smiling face that you could like sit behind. And that kind of stuff, I think, is happening in other countries. I'm not sure if it is in the United States, but like it reminds me of Instagram, Snapchat, even though like kind of putting the cartoon masks over our faces, etc. That kind of gets at a little bit of that. What's underneath the mask, right? And like, why do we need this mask all the time? And I think there's something really deep to that.
I think so. And I mean, you know, I think, you know, in the first episode, that we did together, you know, I mentioned that, you know, originally and always I'm a Russian literature nerd, right?
Right.
I mean,
that's
what I got my BA and my master's in. But I always think even farther back to like, you know, my great literary loves are like, you know, Gogol and Dostoevsky and Bulgakov. And, you know, when I think of Nikolai Gogol, this is exactly like the kind of vision that I have in my head of the world that he was trying to articulate, right? And I think one of the best things ever written about Gogol's work was written by, you know, Vladimir Nabokov in his book on Gogol. And he talks about it in terms of like looking at these like short stories or like the novel that he tried to write, which is like a Russian version of the Divine Comedy, right? And all of the worlds in like kind of rural Russia or in St. Petersburg that he tries to describe. There's always, again, I guess I kind of say in my article, there's this like mud thick mirage of normalcy to everything, and you start to get unnerved by the fact. Well, I mean, first you don't even know what's unnerving you, and then you kind of go back and you start to realize that. As Nabokov like says, there are these little scratches in the surface of the real. There are these little scratches in the details, like a snuff box with like the bust of like a prince on it, and the prince's face has been scratched out, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I mean, like these little sort of details that again kind of alert you to the fact that that there is something deep and dark and unacknowledged in the life that we're living, and that everyone is like low key terrified of recognizing that or of being confronted with the kind of gaping black maw like underneath what they expect.
Yeah, that's the glitch in the Matrix, basically.
Yeah.
You know, the kind of the crack in the ice that you described, you know, the paraphrasing Kafka there. I think that, you know, that's that image is something that we've talked about, you and I, and I know it's come up on this show several times, that the idea of those cracks, you know, those kind of spaces in those spaces that don't quite fit in the surface of our everyday reality that you can kind of see. I mean, we've kind of done it and seen that mainly through a kind of political lens, and I think a cultural one too. Like, to me, it's even like seeing someone with like a Rage Against the Machine shirt. You know what I mean? Like little things, yeah. Little tiny things like that, that kind of to me disrupt and make especially young people question and kind of think like, well, what is that? And I think that the kind of the best kind of artists and the best kind of political people are the ones that are aware that they're creating that crack, if that makes sense. In other words, there are the kind of like the spots we find throughout our reality, like the prince's scratched face on the cigar box, that are kind of like naturally occurring questions that kind of disrupt our understanding of consensus reality. But then there's like the people that are actually constructing the cracks, and I feel like not to get too noble about our mission here. Like I said, we're just doing podcasts here. You know, who gives a fuck? But like working class, or working people, the podcast that you're putting together, I feel like is that's what you're aiming at, right? You're kind of like trying to be a kind of space where you can have the types of conversations and maybe consider the types of information that don't fit for people. And it's that like it's getting in, it's kind of expanding that space and allowing that to be like a legitimate area of discourse. That I guess the thought would be, the more we do that, the more that the more we kind of break the spell.
I think that's exactly right. And to kind of tie all of this, you know, back to what we were talking about in the beginning with my dad, right? You know, that again, that sort of fictive mirage that we kind of like live in and absorb into ourselves in the ways that we operate, right? It's all connected to what we were talking about in terms of like, you know, the alienation of our very kind of social interactions.
Yeah.
Right. In a kind of worldscape of the 21st century where our very social interactions are being kind of absorbed through platforms that can make money off of them. Mm. And that, you know, our social capital is like linked to our presence on social media and stuff like that. So what I kind of talk about in the current affairs piece is that, you know, and this is by no means like a new, you know, hot take, but that, you know, like again, in terms of like this society of the spectacle, like our very understanding of who we are and how we are supposed to interact with each other, right? These have been subsumed by the, you know, capitalistic model and the commodity form, so that, you know, whether we're getting into a heated, you know, quote unquote argument on social media, or whether we are kind of trying to make small talk in an Uber so that we don't get, you know, like a lower grade,
right?
All of these ways that we have kind of taken into ourselves and operate on this notion that every interaction has something to be gained from it in terms that are set by a capitalist kind of system that ultimately, you know, like dehumanizes us and disconnects us from each other and even ourselves. And so we always are looking, consciously or unconsciously, we are looking for ways to use each other, and we have kind of accepted it as a given that we are going to be used.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, again, part of that kind of that frozen kind of sea that we, you know, that is iced over the parts of ourselves that, like I could see in my dad, you know, are crying out under the surface, like are there somewhere in the form even of just like kind of a trace, some sort of scratch in like what we understand as the normal operation of daily life that alerts us to the fact that there is a deep well of pain.
Yeah.
And yearn. And want and a need to connect to each other under the surface that we are constantly denied and that we are constantly denying ourselves and each other. And this was something that I started to see break down in like the conversations my dad was having in Uber, and like, you know, then in the conversations that we were having before he came on the podcast, I could see these sorts of little cracks in the surface. And then we do this first podcast where I talk to him about his life, about, you know, meeting my mom, about getting involved in real estate, and about losing everything in the recession, about voting for Trump, like all these kind of facets of his life that he opened up about in ways that, you know, we had never really been that open and honest with each other. And it was really interesting to me. I think it was really shocking too, that we were being this open with each other, knowing that it was through a conversation that was going to be heard by people on this podcast.
Yeah.
And
that's what you're looking. That's the kind of content you're looking for, my friend. You know,
it is.
I mean, it's weird. It's weird that the turning on the microphones allowed that kind of openness to happen, though. Did you feel like were you nervous about doing this? It seems like a kind of a big deal, especially the fact that you're going to try to, like, I don't know, have the kind of conversation you generally don't have with your dad.
I was very nervous.
Yeah.
For a number of reasons. I mean, like, I guess from the more boring aspect, like I was worried for the first few episodes of the show in general that this was something that people might not even want to listen to, because I'm like, you know, I think I was inspired a lot by listening to your whole back catalog. Like, I really, like you, believe in long form, you know, discussions that, you know, kind of really give enough time and space for people to open up and explore things that they don't normally do in everyday conversation.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I'm glad you're inspired by it. I mean, it's not me, though. I mean, it's the podcast world is like allowing these kind of, like, I don't know. I do desire those, listening to those conversations, and I think other people do too. And it seems like kind of a weird thing that you would want it, but at the same time, I think the popularity of podcasts kind of expresses a little bit of what we've been talking about, which is that kind of, like, the podcasting world allows a kind of interaction that we don't really get and isn't really valued. And even though, yeah, we're like creating, I guess, ostensibly we're creating social media content right now by having this conversation and recording it and putting it out there. But at the same time, I think that, you know, I've mentioned this a few times, because I, you know, my book is about coffee houses during the, you know, during the 1960s and 70s, during the Vietnam War. And the whole notion of the coffee houses was like getting people together to have long conversations where they actually produced knowledge and produced kind of not just knowledge, but a kind of understanding of each other, and maybe even a political and social solidarity that you wouldn't get otherwise, right? That, like, if you just kind of cruise through the culture and basically, you know, post on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook and kind of interact mostly that way, you're never gonna have the kinds of, like, long form interactions. And that's not to say that, like, social media doesn't produce knowledge, or even, I think, produce a kind of tenderness. I think that exists as well. But at the same time, the kind of idea of people using their voices to work through in a different kind of social template is something that people are definitely longing for, and the fact that they're longing for it is should tell us something, right? It should tell us that we miss each other. You know what I mean? Like, we literally we're drifting away from each other in a way that I think is more profound than most people are willing to admit. That, like, I know that this is itself a nostalgia trap to kind of think about, like, oh, what was life like in the 80s and 90s before social media? But, like, you and I grew up during that era, you know, and you and I, like, kind of remember the life before that, before social media. And it does feel like, when I think about it in the long view, it does feel like we interact with each other a lot less. And it feels like our interactions are fraught with this kind of, you know, both the weight of performing for each other for all these different kinds of, you know, rewards. But it's also just, it feels like an age of anxiety, right? It just feels like all my students are complaining about anxiety and, like, performing publicly, socially, more than ever before. It's something like if I ask them to do an assignment that that has them interacting with each other in class or up in front of the class. They all express a deep anxiety that they don't express about kind of like if I ask them to do a a blog, or if I ask them to do like a photo album where we interact online and we do chats online about the material. That stuff they're totally ready to do. But like ask them to like look at each other face to face and have conversations, and that's something that's a little bit trickier for them, and it's not their fault. I mean, they're raised in an era where that stuff I feel like has been degraded. So again, not to like be too ennobling about, you know, what we're doing here at podcasts, but I think that some of it is just putting people back together and like literally kind of like recreating a social space that's been degraded over the years through technology and the kind of weird economy that we're in.
I mean, I think I think you're exactly right. Whether or not this is, indeed part of the reality of what we do, I agree that this is exactly what the mission of what we're doing at these podcasts should be. And it's exactly what I try to articulate the mission of Working People as in the current affairs piece and in the, in the podcast itself when I'm talking to people.
So let's get to that, because I want to talk about what you're doing with General Motors specifically.
Well, yeah. So, let me I have a quick tear that I wanted to wrap that up on.
Do
and
it.
that I think will lead into GM quite well.
Cool.
Like you were saying, we are trying to find each other, and we miss each other. Honestly, if I could get, kind of literary here for a second, I think that even if, if this is the only world that we've ever known, this kind of anxious world that our students are living in, I think that we still do miss each other, but we are missing something that we haven't like yet experienced. Like we are nostalgic for something that we don't yet know, but that we know, we yearn for.
I love that idea. Yeah, nostalgic for a future that hasn't happened yet that we want. Yeah.
Exactly. I think, and that is kind of the entire premise, I think, of your show and of my show and of shows that are doing this kind of work. But I say in the current affairs piece that in all these different ways, the ways that we interact with each other, the ways that we think about ourselves in relationship to the rest of the world, and what we think that the world expects from us, and what we believe we have to perform or how we have to perform in order to kind of maintain some sort of like livability in this kind of political economy that we have, right? All these things operate on us and corrode our very sense of humanity, and that humanity is expressed in a kind of complicated and evolving connectedness to each other and to the world in which we are participating, and in which, we have to learn to live harmoniously and sustainably and affirmingly, and not just, as like Heidegger would say, in this kind of like very instrumentalist way of just seeing the world and our fellow human beings as tools to be used for conquest and gain and the smooth operation of a dehumanizing capitalist machine.
Most people aren't going to have that consciousness of it. Instead, I mean, I feel like most people are just going to experience that as just feeling like shit all the time and not really knowing why. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
That's the real tragedy of it. Yeah.
Yeah. No, we don't necessarily know what it is, but we know we feel like shit. And this goes back to what we started the conversation with, is that we then, and we are encouraged in our culture to do so, we are then taught to internalize this as some sort of psychological problem. We are told to treat it with this or that, regimen of pills, or, all these sorts of ways that we are told to kind of conduct best practices to make ourselves somehow like more manageable, without even seeing the fact that ourselves are reflections of the connections that we have to a world that is killing us.
Yeah.
And that is eroding our life-giving connections to each other. We don't see that, but we know that we need it. And yet, like, if we do not kind of have or give each other the tools to deal with that, we are always going to personalize it and internalize it and forgive the apparatuses of power that are kind of pushing us into these sorts of, you know, like existential quagmires. Mm. And that, again, is I think, like, was the whole premise of Working People. And I think any show or any organization or anything that is attempting to try to, you know, breathe feeling back into the atrophied nerve endings of our common humanity, right? Those things that we know hurt, but we don't know where, right? And then, like, you know, once we start to connect with each other on a level that is more or less foreclosed in this sort of like late capitalist political economy, the more we realize that that is what we are missing. And what we are missing is that sort of human connection to each other. And I think that was the whole premise of Working People, is that I don't know where these conversations are going to go. And I don't know if they're going to be like stuff that people will want to listen to, but I do know that the form that I want it to take, which is long, sprawling, and very attentive, because I think what is more important than like what is said is in communicating to each other that you know, you are listening and that you are actually kind of hearing and affirming and engaging with the kind of complex knots of humanity and time and experience and pain and joy and dreams that we are.
Yeah.
And in engaging in each other with each other in a way that actually sees that, we start to realize how little we do that in our everyday lives and how much we need it.
Well, and social media kind of depends on us needing it in a very kind of like surface and kind of shallow way. We're doing that all the time, right? I feel like every social media post, and I include myself in this, you're every time you post something on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, you're saying like, look at me, notice me, see me, see me, see me, right? Like just desperately wanting to be seen, to be noticed, to be seen as like a valuable in whatever way. And when you think about how degraded that's become, which like just literally like getting the dopamine surge of seeing a notification on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or any of the other social media accounts where it's like you see that little red flag up that you have a new message or a new like, and it's from someone you don't even know and have never met, but yet it gives you some sense of pride and happiness. That to me like kind of has captured and commodified the notion that we're screaming out to be seen and noticed, and it's done it in such a it's created such a degraded thing that, and I think very unsatisfying ultimately, that like people are finding that out, right? That even people with hundreds of thousands of Twitter followers are miserable people, you know? And like that idea seems to be related to what you're talking about here, where there's this kind of collective need to be heard and be noticed in a more profound way than the social media template would allow us to have in most cases.
Right. And you know, like and you know, we talked about how, like, you know, the age of like new media, social media especially, has kind of accelerated this, but it is something that's been there.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Definitely.
Because like, because what I think about is like, you know, the boom of suburbia and all of these like Stepford, you know, like kind of the Stepford fables of people putting out the appearance of like, you know, a manicured lawn and a white picket fence, and then inside their houses, like American Beauty style, like they're just dying inside,
right?
Because they're living for this expectation of what they think society wants of them, and not for what actually like affirms their humanity and makes, you know, the world like enjoyable and livable for them. And I guess to kind of this will be the last time that I mention David Foster Wallace, but connecting him to Kafka, right? Like there is a great little essay that David wrote about Kafka, which was the inspiration for a class that I taught that was like all on comparing Kafka and David Foster Wallace.
Nice.
And he talks about the fact that the hardest thing about teaching Kafka to undergraduates is that they don't realize how funny Kafka is, or like, you know, how where the comedy in what Kafka writes is. We just think of him as this kind of existentialist weirdo, and you know, you wake up and you're a bug kind of thing. But David writes that, like, there is a core joke at the center of what, you know, Kafka was doing, which I think you can see in David's work, but also in so many other, you know, writers' work who try to show, again, that joke at the center of everything that we're talking about. And everything that you know, David said that, you know, this kind of great American sadness manifests in the fact that around middle age, you start to realize the complete vapidity and emptiness at the core of everything you thought was valuable.
Yeah.
And you know, he talks about Kafka kind of embodying this at the kind of turn of the modern world, kind of seeing how this was playing out in the lives and psyches of people trying to live by this standard of happiness that had been set by a system that ultimately wanted to grind them down to dust and bone. And, you know, David, I think, writes, you know, that the core Kafka joke in all of his writing is that the quest to, like, establish a human self results in a self whose humanity is inseparable from that horrific struggle, and that the endless and impossible journey towards home is, in fact, our home. And so we are always, you know, selves in process, waiting for the kind of enjoyment that we were promised if we play by the rules of this system, and then realizing that even if we get there, it is not what we need. And this is where you get all the tired parables of, like, the lonely, sad billionaire,
right?
Or the blue check Twitter celebrity who, you know, for whom, like, the getting, like, thousands of retweets has, like, completely lost any sort of dopamine value whatsoever.
Right,
and it's just
right.
Like, I mean, like, again, all these kinds of ways that we are duped into thinking the system will provide self-affirmation and happiness, only to realize, you know, even if we get to the end of that rainbow, and which most of us do not, you know, but even if we do, we realize that, in fact, looking back, that this was never what we needed, and it's not what
we're chasing nothing, you know, literally chasing something that's not there. And that chase becomes our whole lives. You know what I mean?
Like, exactly.
And that to me is captures some of the real kind of tragedy of everything that we're getting at, is the kind of, like, the idea that we're that lives are stolen. You know what I mean? Like, that lives are stolen because they're spent pursuing something that is not there. And in the service of, I mean, for some people, I think we're talking about levels of class here in some respects too, because, like, you know, you talk about, like, the billionaires and even, like, the Stepford suburban dream, you know, whether it's a particular class of people in America are doing that, but it feels like it's something that ideology of, you know, kind of pursuing material comfort, but kind of the performance of material comfort is something that infects all of us at every level, and that's to me is something that has to be intervened upon, because it's falling through your hands as soon as you're grabbing it, right? It's never really there. It never really and it never really provides the kind of dopamine hit that you get the first time. It is the drug addiction metaphor works in terms of thinking about capitalism and how we're all kind of stuck in this trap of thinking that we're going to get pleasure. That's ultimately always kind of, the pleasure is kind of wrapped up in this kind of slavery, a weird form of mental and sometimes physical slavery.
Right. I mean, we are, you know, it's, God, I'm throwing out all the literary theory.
That's what you do, man.
Garbage.
Yeah.
That's what I do. But I mean, it's what, like, you know, like Derrida called the pharmacon, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
right,
like this thing that is both the cure and the poison. Like, we
right,
are.
Right, exactly. That's,
we are,
I'm glad you remembered that, because the cure and the poison thing was kind of the point I was trying to make, which is that, like, you know, this fun house that you're in with all these doors, as you're walking down the hallway, and the doors are offering this kind of, like, you know, they're offering all sorts of different alleged pleasures that you'll receive in exchange for this life, and yeah, the cure and the poison is that capitalism wants you to feel like shit. You know, capitalism actually makes a lot of money from you feeling like shit. And you mentioned like the whole industries of self-help, industries of even, you know, the pharmaceutical industries for depression and anxiety. I mean, the list goes on and on that capitalism is making money off of your misery while it's creating that misery. And that's something that is an engine and a carousel that we have to step off of. I'm not sure how. Because it seems like that notion is more powerful than ever. The self-help stuff, the kind of like idea that, I mean, even when you go to like Joe Rogan, MMA, the like male lifestyle shit that's out there, Jordan Peterson, everything is about bootstraps right now. Everything is about kind of your ability to make yourself into this like individual and overcome all that misery that's being foisted upon you with no kind of acknowledgement, at least from those sectors of those industries, that the misery is being created by like the very ruling class that's selling you this shit.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's salt water, man. You keep drinking it, and the thirst, you know, just gets worse. And you know, like you were saying, you know, I don't know how you even kind of tackle such a large and pervasive problem. But I guess to make sure we kind of don't get too far afield, like that is kind of the work that you know we are trying to do with these shows, I think, with our teaching, and it's the work that we all need to be doing just in our daily lives, again, to recognize that what we need will not be given to us by the very system that we are describing, right? The master's, in the same way that the master's tools will not, you know, deconstruct the master's house, the master, yeah, like, will not give you, you know, the kind of sucker and affirmation you need to realize how poisonous your relationship to him actually is. That's not his purview, but it has to be ours. And that is why, you know, with working people, and especially with this GM series, right? I tried to articulate in the current affairs piece, and I've tried to articulate over this whole first season of the show, that what is more important than like what is said is the very fact of these conversations taking place at all, and the very fact of people then kind of being encouraged to go and have these sorts of conversations with their own families and their own coworkers and their neighbors, right? But to start somewhere, to try to remind working people who in this system that we're talking about are told day after day that their lives and their stories count for less, and that they don't matter as much as the lives and stories of people that we see in our media or that go viral or these all these sorts of ways that, again, we are taught to strive to be something we are not, which keeps us from becoming something we could. And it's I think it's a pervasive and devastating, you know, facet of capitalism to make us kind of always feel that we are in need of something that we, in fact, have the power to give each other.
Yeah.
And to believe that it can only come from, you know, some sort of producer or power on high. But I guess what you know, we are trying to do with these shows, and what people who are actually not just sitting around talking about the working class, but workers who are talking to each other are trying to do, is to remind ourselves that, in fact, our lives do matter, our stories matter, and that we need to remind each other of that by giving that sort of undivided attention, by listening to each other in a sort of open, non-judgmental, you know, way, and then, like, in the process, searching more honestly and more openly for the kind of common terrain upon which we could build a world that is livable for all of us.
Yeah. And to me, that kind of erasure that we're talking about, the erasure of, you know, who you really are, you know, that human beings under capitalism don't ever kind of reach their full potential because they're lost within this capitalist system, spent really giving their lives and their labor over to capital in that way. That you know, I just wanted to point out, because I can hear people already like listening to this and kind of talking about how unequal that process is, because it is the erasure is distributed unequally, right? That like people of color, women have been erased historically more, and had their lives destroyed in this way that kind of, to me, is mind-boggling and gets to the larger point of what we've lost. And like, to me, like there's a great example of this that I saw this weekend in one of those like kind of tweet threads that was about, I don't know if you saw this, it was about a academic conference in Germany, a scientific conference. It was a medical conference. Either way, they decided to do for the first time the recipients are all the people that applied to be on panels and speak, all the different academics. They did it anonymously, so they didn't know who was there, because what they had problems with the representation at these conferences before was basically all white dudes. So they decided to just do it anonymously and see, like, you know, take whatever ones by merit. And what they ended up with was 82% women were the panel participants, were the ones that were chosen. And the thought that came up from that, and was not a thought necessarily made by me, but by a bunch of others, you know, is the idea that, you know, how much we've lost just by like erasing, you know, people. And erasing their lives, and like leave, the capital has left them out, whether they be poor, you know, it's always poor people, but it's often, you know, more often it's been women, it's been people of color, and how much potential, like human potential, even just like scientific, technological knowledge, literary and artistic contributions, all of that stuff has been erased. And to me, like, that's like just not a smart society, right? Like a society that is taking all that human potential and kind of wasting it in the landscape of capitalism, where it's just basically sucking up the energy from these bodies just to get back to the matrix. You know, you're sitting here citing all the kind of like high literary stuff, but I've got the matrix and kind of the you know. But the idea that we're all like in that, I thought that the first Matrix had a really compelling, you know, visual kind of representation of that, of like human bodies laying in these pods, you know, being used as batteries. And it seems like that's an image that kind of captures a little bit of what we're talking about too, which is that, you know, lives spent as batteries to charge a system that never really trickles down its benefits to you, means that that's what you are. It means that your life has been stolen, and that in America, in the United States, in American history, that process of erasure has been a really unequal one. And we've talked like for an hour. We haven't really gotten to General Motors like specifically, but I want to get to it. Maybe we can come back to it on another program, because I love having you on, Max. But I want to talk about GM a little bit, because it feels like that erasure is something that's happened to like the kind of in the American imagination about people that work at General Motors. And what I mean by that is like we have this mythical notion of the industrial working class as if it's like disappeared, as if it's already gone. The same way we talk, and when I say we, I think like the mainstream Americans, but more like in the kind of media landscape we have, you know, and even the Native Americans are the same way. People tend to think of Native Americans as like they're like people that lived in the past. They're all gone, as if their struggle isn't like still going on in the 21st century. And the stuff that you're doing with General Motors, and specifically since General Motors, and I'd like you to kind of like talk a little bit about like what's specifically happening with General Motors, but they're in the middle of big big layoffs in the Midwest, and it seems like, you know, that's part of this idea that we have, that the working class, especially the kind of like industrial factory working class, is something that already is gone, and it already happened. Deindustrialization happened in the 70s and 80s, and we don't have factories anymore. But you're talking to people that work at General Motors factories, that work within the industrial kind of core of the Midwest that's still there. So what are you finding out? And I know it's a big question, but what are you finding out, and what can you tell us about like what's specifically happening with GM right now? Because the headlines that I'm seeing are that, you know, something like 14,000 jobs are being lost right now. So can you tell us like a little more specifically about what's happening with GM?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, I know that we've kind of front loaded everything with like the more philosophical aspect to everything, but I honestly do think that, you know, if folks listen, I think anyone who listens to your podcast, this will all make a lot of sense. And I think anyone who listens to my podcast, especially the GM series, everything that we're talking about will really make a lot of sense in the context of the format of the show, right? Which is that in every episode, I talk, you know, for an hour and a half, sometimes longer, to, you know, another member of the working class, another worker from somewhere around the U.S. And we just talk about their life. We talk about their job, their dreams, their struggles. And we really just, yeah, like kind of focus on them and kind of learn about them. And in the process, we kind of begin to find, again, these sorts of connections to each other and connections to what other workers on other episodes have said, and realize that, in fact, there are way more parts of this struggle that we have in common than not. And even in the GM series, which to listeners who don't know about it yet, you know, like once so it was the Monday after Thanksgiving that this announcement came from Mary Barra, the CEO of GM, that five plants would be idled over the next, you know, year or 2 years. 14,000 jobs around that would be cut, some white collar, some blue collar, and that plants again would be closing in Michigan, Ohio, Maryland, and in Oshawa, Canada. And so, you know, I thought it was really important, especially as I was watching like the mainstream media coverage of this, where, you know, it was all so goddamn like bland and predictable and simplistic, especially in talking about the actual workers who were now kind of having their lives upended weeks before the holidays. And
you know what that reminds me so much, and this what I think that my listeners would hook up with the General Motors thing, and I think that it's something that everyone who listens to Nostalgia Trap should go check out Max's show, Working People, and particularly listen to the General Motors stuff that to get a kind of idea of what you're doing, because you know, for me, and I've told this story before, and it's come up on the show a million times, that like, you know, the story of GM in particular is something that was an entryway to the whole of understanding capitalism. I was shown the movie Roger and Me, Michael Moore's first film. You know, it wasn't a professor; it was a high school economics teacher. I was 15 years old. I had no idea what any of this stuff was. It was just like the boring movie we were going to watch in the afternoon after lunch and try not to fall asleep. But he wheeled in, you know, the VCR, old school. You know, this is probably, you know, this is early 90s. He wheeled in the VCR, showed us Roger and Me. And this was this high school teacher with like the ponytail and the earring. You know, this was like literally the stereotype of the kind of like liberal hippie guy in California. So he knew what he was doing. But Roger and Me blew my mind because it was the first time I'd really thought about the relationship between corporations and human beings. I mean, it made me think about my father, because my dad worked for the telephone company, General Telephone, which turned into Verizon. He worked there for 40 years. And so, you know, I'd never really thought about how closely his fate and his actual everyday life was tied to a company that really didn't care about him. And that part of it was devastating to me, because I'd never really thought about how profound that is and how scary it is, too. So anyway, like the GM story is one that I think that a lot of young people, especially that saw Roger and Me, and also know about the kind of the wider history of Flint, Michigan, the stuff that's going on with water there has been in the news for what, like 3 years now. So like I feel like it's a well-known story in some sense among people on the left, that like General Motors has had this particular relationship to the working class there, but it I love what you're doing in that, you know, you're bringing the story into the 21st century. I think that, you know, Roger and Me is a film that came out in what, like 1989 or something like that. It's a long time ago, but the story is one that keeps going. And it seems like the work that you're doing is getting in there and continuing to expand upon that particular history. That's I think an important entryway into understanding capitalism in total.
Well, and I mean, I'm very happy to hear that for sure. I mean, like, because especially for this GM series, it's been a real slog putting this together over, you know, trying to get it out over 2 weeks, because it's a multi-episode series. So there are 5 episodes in total that I released over 2 weeks. Every episode contains multiple interviews with workers from the Oshawa plant in Canada, the 2 plants in the Detroit area, and then 3 workers at the iconic Lordstown plant in Ohio. And then a final, there's also a bonus episode with the labor activist Sam Gindin.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, which is that's available on Patreon if you become a patron.
Do it.
And then there's a final, you know, massive kind of clip episode where, you know, I collected just like 30-minute conversations with 6 different workers, organizers, writers, thinkers, all kinds of people giving different perspectives on the layoffs and how they connect to the labor movement and to the question of deindustrialization writ large. So there's a whole hell of a lot of stuff.
And it sounds like by bringing in Sam Gindin and bringing in a kind of a range of voices, it sounds like you're hitting this from a bunch of different angles, and that's what I like about it. It's kind of like there's a personal thing going on, there's a cultural thing going on, but it sounds like you're also, you know, there's a kind of the politics of all this is important too. Is it tricky to speak to especially when you're speaking to like GM workers? Or even like speaking to your father, is it tricky to kind of negotiate the politics of it? Because you're coming at it from such a different angle. And what I mean by that is, like, here on this show, Nostalgia Trap, most of the people I've interviewed have been like academics that have a particular they've read a particular set of literature, basically. And so, like, there's that base of, like, you know, political understanding that's very easy for me to just be like, hey, you know, you remember this, you remember that from grad school. But it seems like the bridge of talking to GM workers about politics seems like the conversations could go anywhere. So how do you kind of navigate that?
I mean, it is and it isn't hard, because
well, you have an identity of your. I mean, you're a working class guy yourself, so I mean, it seems like there's that natural kind of rapport is there too.
There, I mean, yeah. So there is, but also, right? It's easy, you know, and if you, again, you start to build trust with the person that you're talking to, and you do that by actually listening to them. Mm-hmm. I think that a lot of people would be very surprised to learn how malleable, you know, like, our relationships to each other can be if we actually approach them in good faith, and if we actually give each other the time of day to validate each other's life experiences and to hear each other's stories. And when I'm talking to these workers, some of whom are like, you know, deep red Trump voters from Ohio, and some who like describe themselves as like GM workers who are anarchists, right? I mean, there's a broad range of folks, and there are also a lot who are, yeah, there are a lot who are also more in the middle,
yeah,
right? And you know, again, like, if I want to put my money where my mouth is and communicate to the people I'm talking to and to the people who are listening that, like, I truly believe that the underlying value of this sort of show is in not in, like, directing conversations one way or the other, or giving listeners like some sort of like pre-packaged conversation that they were already expecting or hoping for
yes.
going in, right? That more important than that is the fact of the conversation itself, and the realization that if you do what we have to do, which is connecting with our fellow workers and finding pathways to building solidarity out of our shared humanity and out of our common struggle, you know, you will start to realize that, in fact, people are way more willing to meet you on that terrain than they may be when you're talking to them on Twitter or at an academic conference.
Yep.
And I think this speaks to a much larger kind of problem with the very ways that we on the left like actually understand the political task ahead of us, right? Is that so much of our self-referential, you know, kind of conversations are dancing around questions about the working class that demonstrate to everyone that, in fact, like we are not making the working class a part of this conversation.
Right.
And that our relationships to our fellow workers are not informing the kind of like strategy that we need to have and the kind of vision for a world that we need to build with each other. Right. And that's kind of like, you know, what good is it then, right? I mean, like, what good is it if it exists only in these sort of ideological and communicative silos that have no bearing whatsoever on the lives and struggles of our fellow workers?
I totally agree. I mean, we see that a lot on the left, the same kind of putting working class people into this kind imaginary box through which you can kind of manipulate the politics around an idea of the working class rather than the real working class and the actual human beings that comprise it. That seems like a big problem for the left as well as the right, is the kind of like how they're conceiving of it. And even like, you know, I think you're right. I love the idea of just talking to everybody because it's something we don't get. Even like, I'm thinking about like those awful like years, I guess it's years now, of like political campaigns where you have presidential candidates going into like, you know, the local diner somewhere in Ohio and like, you know, putting and having coffee with the working class. I mean, all those kinds of really shitty kind of media representations, they reinforce all that kind of like all those old ideas. And it seems like sitting down and actually talking to people for a few hours, that's something that, you know, you only get as tokens in the media. Is it Thomas Friedman that always talks about like his taxi driver, right? He's always like making these like ridiculous like, oh, I talked to a taxi driver and then I put my finger on the pulse of the working class, you know, it seems like the left does that too, you know, and especially the kind of like, I don't know, I, you know, academic left or whatever, the kind of the left that has a lot more attention than it should, the kind of like, I don't know, the scenes we talk about on this show a lot are like the Brooklyn left, etc. And there's a lot of good people there, but at the same time, there's also this kind of separation and a tendency, I think, a lot to kind of, again, put working class people into a particular box that they can then, you know, match to their political, to their kind of, their kind of political points. And that to me is going nowhere. That's, again, like kind of like really not really dealing with the working class as a diverse set of actual human beings with interests and yearnings that are different than the kind of, I don't know, straight kind of Bernie Sanders political economy we're often presented with.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. And I guess to round things out, there are just like kind of two things that I wanted to say about that. Is that, yeah, to your point about the left, right? Yeah, like this is most certainly a problem that we have to deal with and that we have to address like honestly and in good faith.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to recognize that, you know, we need to stop kind of using the working class as this sort of like symbol to be colonized and appropriated and absorbed into our own personal brands, because that's kind of what it is right now. It is a symbol that people are battling with each other to kind of claim dominion over in order to boost like their own kind of ideological brand in this left media sphere. And that's exactly what, like you said, like a lot of folks in like the Brooklyn left, the so-called dirtbag left, are trying to do, and often to disastrous consequences.
Yeah.
I mean, the elephant in the room is that you have dipshits like Angela Nagel talking about how the left case against open borders, quote unquote, is actually like the only kind of left opinion out there that's really taking seriously how left positions will impact the lives and struggles of real working people, because, you know, undocumented laborers, you know, like act as a form of wage suppression to, you know, workers here in the U.S. and blah, 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 blah. And then you have kind of like this stable of like other people in this camp who just like cheer on people like Angela Nagel and assume that anyone who disagrees with her is like, you know, a piece of shit. So you have like additional quote unquote useful idiots, to use Angela's term, like Amber Frost and you know, other people again who just kind of act as if like their connection to the working class is a trump card that means that anyone, you know, in this like fictive notion of or this kind of like built up notion of who the academic left or who the writing left is, you know, they are trying to distance themselves from that, but they are doing so by using the working class in these very instrumentalist ways instead of like actually doing the hard work of talking to the working class, working with the working class beyond their own immediate sphere. And Angela Nagel's like article is a perfect fucking example of that, because if you listen to any of the episodes in my show, especially the episodes in the GM series, you will notice that the one thing that never fucking comes up is like immigration. None of these workers at GM, none of them mention that like migrant labor is, you know, the reason that that they have been like fleeced decade over decade to like give up more concessions in order to just like beg to keep their jobs, which are being held hostage every negotiating period, right? Ultimately, to end up at the point where they've ended up now, where GM and other companies like Harley Davidson, like Carrier, like metal workers, this is happening all over the goddamn country.
Yeah,
it's not just GM.
I'm glad that that stuff is coming up on your show, like or I guess not coming up. The idea that folks like Angela Nagel get away with it a lot, you know, kind of saying things that like that they for whatever reason they're taken as kind of speaking for an authentic working class, which is weird to me. It seems like, you know, the interviews you're having are kind of giving the lie to that idea.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to know why Angela Nagel is full of shit, just listen to the episodes in the GM series, or just talk to.
That's how,
you know,
I'm
going like to
promote this
worker.
Episode. Your episodes on Twitter. You should just be like, you know. Because
yeah,
you know,
please do
again those fights on Twitter. You know, those left the Angela Nagel stuff. You know, I almost feel like she and the other people you've mentioned, they function as trolls in a lot of ways. You know, they function as like essentially they come up with this kind of contrarian idea that they can kind of think they can fit into a supposedly left-wing frame, which I to me, like a lot of what Nagel says sounds like just straight right-wing bullshit. Like it doesn't sound left at all. Like the kind of left case for the left case against open borders doesn't sound like much of a left case at all, especially when you consider the like main point she's making about how workers themselves are the ones that are going to suffer from this. And I mean, she's talking about like a quote-unquote American workers, right? All of it just seemed like the same kind of like divisive racist bullshit that capitalism loves.
And honestly, like I think you're exactly right. And I guess to finish on this point, like again, if you talk to any of these workers, and I would again point people to the GM series, and I'm doing so because it's the workers themselves who are saying this. It's not me. It's not anyone else.
Yeah.
But like, listen to them, and every one of them will tell you, even the Trump voters, like they know the score. They know that it's not other members of the working class who are their enemies. Like even those who really disagree with what the strategy of the union should be, they still have a deep tenderness and sense of responsibility to their brothers and sisters in the union and their brothers and sisters who are working in industries all across, you know, the world.
Yeah.
Right. And they will tell you in a way that is way more convincing and way more important than anything Nagel or Frost or those fucking dipshits are writing. And so stop engaging with this bullshit online cults of personality pseudo-politics. Talk to our fellow workers. Talk to each other. And you will find that they know that, in fact, this is the end point for all of us, right? What the GM workers are going through, like, this is what kind of capitalism's end game is, right? Is to use us for everything that we're worth, to have no sense of responsibility whatsoever to the people who are creating value and to the communities that are being built outside, you know, like, of these plants. Like, they don't give a shit about that. Mary Barra has said openly when she announced these layoffs right after Thanksgiving, we only have one allegiance, and that is to our shareholders.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And so these workers know that, in fact, A, like, this is not a problem that, you know, like, is that other members of the working class, other segments of the labor force should be blamed for. We know who our enemies are because they are telling us to our fucking face that they are, that yep. they are our yep. enemies. Yep. And they also know that you cannot fight this. I think a worker from Oshawa said it beautifully in that episode. He said, you cannot fight a multinational corporation. You cannot fight global capitalism on purely nationalistic terms, which is what someone like Angela Nagel is fucking proposing.
Yeah, I know.
Like, what you need is international, widespread worker solidarity. You need to talk to each other and realize that it doesn't have to be this way. We need to be showing up for each other. Like you mentioned, like, politicians going to these towns and just kind of, like, acting like they know the workers and then leaving them.
Yeah.
Right? We need to do what capitalism does not do for us. We need to be there for each other. If there is a strike in your area, go to it. If there isn't, like, you know, contact local unions, contact labor clubs, contact organizations that are doing good work. Like, no one has to do everything, but everyone has to do something.
Yeah.
And what we need, and we need to be showing our fellow workers that we are not, again, just out to use them. And we are not there to use each other. We are there to be there for each other, to take our common struggle up collectively, and to, out of that, build the architecture for a better world and a better, more sustainable political economy that you know, is not you know, like, going to give us the soul killing, planet killing shit that we have now.
Yeah. And I love that I want to kind of end on that note, that the politics, that so much of what we're talking about with the kind of, like, Brooklyn left or whatever, or the kind of academic politics, whatever, the idea that, like, politics are where you start. You start with the politics, and then you go apply that to this mythical working class that you've never fucking met in your life. Instead, it seems like the politics have to emerge out of a solidarity that is, you know, this kind of, like, rediscovering a shared humanity, you know, and that we need to, the politics will emerge after we become a family again, you know, and, like, becoming the family and reconstituting that idea of a human family rather than the kind of, like, I don't know, atomized nuclear family that we've seen, but instead kind of crossing all those barriers to create the kind of seeing each other that we really are longing for. And that so much of we talked about in this program is, like, this social media is this kind of cheap version of us reaching out to each other. We need to create a culture that allows that reaching out that never really grasps each other's hands on social media. We need to make that real, you know, and that part of what we're doing with these podcasts is trying to create that. And I just wanted to reinforce for everyone that's listening to go check out Max's podcast, Working People, support his podcast on Patreon, and you know, help do what you can to kind of build a culture of human connection. That doesn't mean we're not using the internet. It doesn't mean that social media doesn't have a role to play, but it means that we need to not just let it be that. We need to actually connect with the people we're talking about and connect with each other. And in doing so, that's the kind of key to building the kind of political utopia, if such a thing exists, that we're aiming for. So Max, shit, man, I love talking to you. Thanks so much for for sharing your work today. You're doing good stuff.
Thanks, brother. You too. Thanks for having me on, man. And hopefully we'll get to see each other in SoCal sometime soon.
Sweet. All right, man. Take care. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for listening to this program. And thank you, Max Alvarez, for sharing your insights. I always enjoy just listening to Max talk about what's going on. I think he's got a great take on things. And you should check out his all his work. But his podcast, Working People, is something that I think is worth your time and worth supporting. So go check that out on Patreon, etc. And if you've got the bucks, support the Nostalgia Trap as well on patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. I appreciate it. We appreciate it. Thanks for a great 2018, and we'll see you again. Take care. Bye-bye.